What's up, everybody? My name is Max Feinstein, and I'm an anesthesia resident at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. Today, I'm going to show you how I set up my operating room to get ready to start a case. I'm going to be using the standard MS MAIDS mnemonic, which I'll go ahead and narrate for you so you can follow along. If you find this video interesting or helpful, I'd really appreciate it if you like it and subscribe to the channel. Got about 20 minutes here, so let's go ahead and get started. I don't exactly have a bunch of pro audio and video recording equipment, but I do have this handy IV pole, so I'll go ahead and get my camera set up here so you can see everything that I'm doing. And the first part of getting ready for my case is going with the M in the MS MAIDS mnemonic, which stands for machine. And so the first thing that I'm going to do with my machine is actually go around to the back, and I'm going to open up the oxygen tank. So this isn't actually where the oxygen normally comes from the machine. This is a backup tank. But in the event that there's any sort of issue with the oxygen coming off of the wall, then I'll have this tank as a backup that's available. And it's important to make sure at the beginning of each day that there's an adequate amount of oxygen in the tank. And then once that's open, I can walk around the front of the machine and I can pull up and see what the gauge pressure is on that tank. And this tank, when full of oxygen, is about 2100 or 2200 PSI. I can see this is 1649. And I want it to be more than half, so that should be fine. The next part of making sure that my machine is ready to go is doing a machine test. So I'm gonna go ahead and start a full test, which requires that I'm on vent mode and that I've got my Y pipe disconnected. And so that test is gonna run with the rest of my machine check, which is gonna include looking at gases to make sure that my volatile cartridges are full. And then I also need to get to the back of the machine again and turn my O2 tank off, because if I don't do that, there's a possibility that it may actually leak throughout the course of the day and become empty when I actually need it. Next up is S for suction, which is a simple and quick part of the setup, but definitely not to be overlooked. They say that the two most important things to save somebody's life are suction and an ambu bag, which I'll get to soon. And the suction works. So we'll move along to the next letter, which is M again, and this time it's for monitors. So I'm going to get my American Society of Anesthesiologists standard monitor set up. Here I've got an EKG lead. I'm going to have 5 EKG leads set up. Next is a temperature probe. This one is a stick-on temperature probe, but I can also take the sticker off to insert, for example, in somebody's nostril. Next is a blood pressure cuff. And I don't show it here, but also capnography for end-tidal CO2 monitoring. I'm also not showing it here, but we have pulse oximetry that's bundled in with all the rest of these cables next to my EKG leads. And this is personal preference here, but I do like to get my EKG stickers attached to the cables so that I can quickly attach them once a patient comes into the room. But watch out, because once these stickers are attached to the cables, they can very quickly become tangled. Next up is A for airway. So I'll start with a MAC 3 blade, which you'll choose your blade size depending on your patient's height and weight and gender, and also an endotracheal tube. This is a 7.0 internal diameter tube, also dependent on patient's height, weight, and gender. And then I've got a stylet, which is not necessary, but depending on your preference may make intubation easier. And then a 10cc syringe, which I'm going to fill with air so that I can inflate the cuff in my endotracheal tube. And an oral airway is essential for both the beginning and end of a case. And eye tape and tape for the endotracheal tube. It's also important to go ahead and open up your endotracheal tube and test the cuff to make sure that there aren't any leaks, because that could be a huge problem if there was a leak from the manufacturer and you didn't discover it until the middle of the case. This one's good. I'll go ahead and deflate the cuff. And since personally I like to use a stylet to intubate, I'll go ahead and get my stylet placed. And then I'll make the classic hockey stick shape, which is what I've gotten used to intubating patients with. I always like to have my eye tape ready to go. I tape a patient's eyes closed pretty much immediately after induction, and then I get my oral airway open so it's ready for use. The last part of my airway check is I make sure my ambu bag works. Like I said, this can be an essential part of saving someone's life. Next up on the list is I for IV. So I'm going to start with this bag of crystalloid. In this case, I'm using plasmalite. I like to keep a couple stopcocks in between my IV tubing so that I can easily add new lines or inject medication or disconnect and reconnect the tubing really easily. So I'm just being extra careful to not touch any part of the tubing that will touch any medication that will go into the patient. Now I'll go ahead and spike this IV, which is important because I want to run fluid through the IV tubing so that I don't have any air by the time that I connect it to the patient. The next part of the IV setup is I like to put together little IV kits. So I'll start with some 4x4 gauze and get three of these laid out for three different IV kits. I've got rubber bands that I use for tourniquets, as well as tape to tape down my IVs. I'll also get out alcohol pads and tegaderms, which in addition to the tape will keep the IV nice and secure. I like to go ahead and get all of this laid out. Then I'll go ahead and get out two 20 gauge needles for each IV kit, bundle everything up, put some tape on top, and then rubber band it all together. At your institution, you may have pre-made IV kits or different equipment, or other people may do your IVs for you. So this is really just a matter of personal preference, but either way, you need to make sure that you've got adequate IV equipment in order to take care of your patient. Next is drugs, which for me begins with getting out all of my syringes. So as I'm getting all of this out, I've got in mind exactly what medications I'm going to want to have drawn. Again, it's important to maintain sterility here, which means either wearing gloves or making sure not to touch the part of the syringe or the needle that it will come into contact with any substance that will come into contact with the patient. For the case I'm doing today, I want to start with rocuronium, a non-depolarizing muscular blocker. I'd also like to have succinylcholine drawn up, which is a depolarizing neuromuscular blocker. I'd like to have reversal agents, so I'll start with glycopyrrolate. And then a little later on, I'll also get some neostigmine. Yellow sticker here for propofol, which will be part of my induction. I also typically drop some fentanyl, which is helpful for pain control and reducing the amount of anesthetic gas that I need to give a patient. Next is midazolam, also known as Versed, which we typically use for anxiolysis just before induction. And here's neostigmine, which will be part of my reversal of neuromuscular blockade. Next is dexamethasone, which is a helpful antiemetic that I give at the beginning of cases generally. Next is ondansetron, or Zofran, which is also an antiemetic, but I tend to give that at the end of the case when I give it. And here's a label for some lidocaine, which can be helpful for reducing the amount of discomfort that's caused by propofol. And then in this particular card, I've got pre-made syringes of phenylephrine and ephedrine, which I like to get out. And now I'm going to go ahead and pull out all the vials of the drugs that I'm about to draw up. When I draw up drugs, I always triple check everything that I'm drawing up. So I start by comparing the labeled syringe with the labeled vial and make sure they're the same. And so with that, I'll go ahead and draw it up. And as I'm drawing it up, I'm again checking the labeled syringe against the vial to make sure that it's the same. And then I always do a third check right here at the end, just making sure that both labels pair up. I realize that this is extremely redundant, but I would much rather spend a little bit of extra time to make sure that I've got the right medication, because this is a place where medication errors can happen extremely easily. Here's my rocuronium. Here's my glycopyrrolate. And also, if you're interested in learning more details about the medications that are stocked in this cart, you can check out this video narrated by Dr. Erica Fagelman, one of the former chief residents and current liver transplant anesthesia fellows at Mount Sinai Hospital. Next up is neostigmine. Here I've got dexamethasone, more dexamethasone. Here's my ondansetron or Zofran. This is 2% lidocaine. I'm going to draw up 5 milliliters of it. Now I'll go ahead and put all of my drugs in a lockbox and some controlled substances I'll need to drop later once the pharmacy opens. And the last part of the mnemonic is S for special, which really entails any special equipment that's going to be needed for the case. And in this case, I'm grabbing an ultrasound because I'm going to be doing a transversus abdominis plane block. Now that I've got the ultrasound in the room, I want to make sure that I've got my cleaning solution, syringes, needles, stopcocks, and then I'll also have to go ahead and grab my local anesthetic from the room next door. All right, well, that's everything that I need to get started with this case. I use the MS MAIDS mnemonic every day, and most of my colleagues do the same thing. It's an essential part of the anesthesiologist toolbox. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. Thank you. Bye.